to all of you, dear friends. So we'll move on to the next session of instruction set, that is lecture number 8. In the previous class, we have discussed about the control instructions, such as conditional as well as unconditional. In the conditional instruction, we have bitwise as well as bytewise. When it comes to bitwise, either it is the condition checked with the carry flag or the zero flag, or it is the bit associated with the bit addressable memory. We need to note here is when it is for the zero flag, it is always with the accumulator itself. Then similarly, with respect to the unconditional jump instruction, we have covered the A jump, that is absolute jump, small jump, as well as the long jump. And these instructions are being explained or understood through the range of jump. Either it is relative or it is absolute or long. To understand these instructions, we have taken a few looping examples. Now we will have the discussion on the directives. So what are these directives? So recollecting back with the analogy of a C program, in C program, many a times you use certain inbuilt functionalities such as hash define. Okay, so what that hash define does, whenever you use that hash define, you associate a variable and a value to it. So that the variable which is being, when being used in the complete program, will always be replaced with whatever the value that is being associated. In the similar context, in order to make the assembler execute the program with respect to, say, the memory allocation for a particular variable, or it could be with respect to the space that has to be given for some variables, there are assembler directives. These assembler directives are not the actual instructions as we have discussed, like for example add, sub, move, but these are the directives which instruct the assembler to create a certain machine code for an instruction, wherein it will be able to process the subsequent assembly language or the instruction that is being written. It also helps in defining certain program constants, and it reserves space for the variables. So here we'll be discussing on the commonly used directives in an assembly program. So the first one that we have is the ORG, which is origin. So you need to tell the assembler where should your program begin. So the syntax would be ORG, associated with it a value. Normally the program counter on reset would be set to a value of 00. So which means that the program will start, or the program when written and it is being loaded into the memory of 8051 would start at the address 000h. So when you use origin, you need to define the value as 000h. If you don't define, it's fine, it automatically takes with the value of 00. But say for example you want the program not to originate at 00 but some other location, fine, then what can be done is you can specify that address. So the program counter, instead of being loaded with the value of 00, it gets loaded with whatever value that is being specified along with the original directive. So original directive is used to indicate the starting address. It can be used only when the program counter need to be changed. That's what we said. The program counter on reset will be 00. So your program will start default at the location 00. But if at all you feel that your program should originate, say, at 1000h, then explicitly you have to write ORG and the address. But in a normal practice, what we do is we always start the program with ORG 000h as a syntax to be followed. And the number that comes after the ORG can either be a decimal value or it can be a hexadecimal value. The next one that we have is EQ, which means equal or equate. Now, what is the use of this directive? So the use of this directive is basically to assign a value which remains constant throughout your program to a particular variable. So the directive assign does a numerical value or a register name to a specified symbol name. It is used to define a constant without storing information in the memory. So it does not store any information into that particular memory. It is a temporarily that can be assigned to a variable. So it is basically a symbolic definition that takes place with respect to the EQU. And you should also see that the one which is being used, any variable that you used along with EQ, should not be redefined anywhere into the program again. So it is going to lead to a syntax error as well as some compiler error into the program. So in the example that you see, we have said key EQ0x25. So in the main program, when you use this variable as a key, fine, so where you can directly use it as a key, then what happens? In place of the key, the value 25 would be associated with. So the advantage of using this directive is, say for example, a certain value is being used more number of times into the program, and to execution, or you want to test your program wherein you want to change the value. Fine, instead of going into some 5 to 6 places where you have to keep on changing that particular value, what can be done is simply you change the value into this variable that is key. Fine, instead of 25, you make it as 35. So that gets reflected everywhere, wherever that variable key is being used. The next directive that we have is define byte, DB, which is define byte. So this is a directive which is being used to define an 8-bit data. So when you execute a program and you want to make it as more interactive, then what can be done is you can define the variables. Fine, you can define the variables. And the variables should be of the type byte. Why? Because you know 8051 is a 8-bit microcontroller, which means that it can process 8-bit of the data at a given time. So the define byte is a directive which helps in initializing a memory for a particular variable which can store 8-bit of the data. Now what could be the a definition that can be assigned to a particular variable? So when you are using this define byte, now the number that you use, right, can either be a decimal, it can be a binary, it can be a hexadecimal, or it can be in the form of ASCII equivalent also. So whenever you use a decimal, either you can end it with a value, I mean with a variable D, which is again optional. So if you don't specify anything, automatically it would be considered as a decimal value. But it is very mandatory that you have to specify B for a binary data that is being assigned to a variable of the type byte, as well as for the hexadecimal as H. And if it is the ASCII, that means you want to assign a string to a variable using this directive as defined byte, then it is required that you have to write that particular string in the quotes. Either it can be single or it can be double. So let us see the example. So look at this example. Data 1. Okay, data 1 is a variable which is of the type DB, which means defined byte. So 1 byte of the memory space is being allocated to the variable data 1, and the value that is being loaded into that memory which is assigned to data 1 would be 40H. Okay. Then similarly, we have the next variable as data 2, which is again of the type byte. But what we have done over here is, instead of writing the data either in the form of a decimal or in the form of hexadecimal, we have used the binary equivalent. So as you can see, we have written B. It's a must, otherwise it gives a syntax error, because the controller does not understand if you write it in, I mean the assembler rather does not understand if you simply write these bits without associating it with a variable as B. Now the next example that we have is data 3, which is DB, and we have assigned value 48. So if you do not write H, then default it becomes a decimal value 48. But what gets loaded internally would be the hexadecimal of the value 48 that gets loaded into the variable in the memory location associated with data 3. And the next one we have is the variable as data 4 defined by it, H-E-L-O, hello. So let us understand this a little deeper. Now the complete string is being written in the form of, I mean a complete string is nothing but the, it has the ASCII equivalent, right? So H will have a ASCII equivalent, E will have the ASCII equivalent, L also will have its ASCII equivalent, again L ASCII equivalent, and O also will have the ASCII equivalent, which means that the variable data 4 will be allocated with the memory space of 5 consecutive locations. Why 5 consecutive locations? Because every letter has an ASCII equivalent, and the ASCII equivalent requires 8 bits of the memory to be allocated. So H would require 1 byte of the memory space, E would require another byte of the memory space, L would require 2 consecutive, and O. So the variable data 4 would be allocated with 5 consecutive memory locations, and the content of those memory locations will be the ASCII equivalent of H, the ASCII equivalent of E, the ASCII equivalent of L, again the ASCII equivalent of L, and then the ASCII equivalent of O. Okay, so this is how we can use the directive as define byte. The next directive that we have is end directive, which is again the most important or the mandatory directive which has to be used in our program. So what this directive indicates is, it indicates that it is the end of the assembly program. Okay, so the assembler, when it reads this directive, it understands that there are no more further instructions that need to be assembled and further compiled as well as executed. So any instruction that is written after the end directive will be ignored. Okay, so you will not be using, or rather no instruction would be executed after the end of after the end directive. Okay, then if the end statement is missing, the assembler will generate an error message. So that's what we said, that it is a mandatory that you have to use the end directive. So let us go with the first program. Write an 8051 assembly program to move 10 block of data from location 40H to 50H. So what the problem statement says, that we have to copy 10 bytes of the data which are held at the location 40H to the location 50H. So here the count is 10, 40H will be the source, I mean starting address of the source, and 50H would be the starting address of the destination. So the logic or the algorithm goes like this. Initialize the counter, the source pointer, as well as the destination pointer. So here we need to remember is, in case of 8051, only two registers, that is R0 and R1, are used to hold the RAM address. Next, copy a byte of data from the source to the destination through the accumulator, which implies that there cannot be a direct data copy between the memory locations. It has to be done through the accumulator. Once the first byte of the data is being copied, we increment the source as well as the destination pointer. So it becomes 40
1 and 51. Decrement the count. Since already one byte of the data is being copied, so you decrement the count. You check whether the count is equal to 0 or not. If it is not equal to 0, then we have to go back and repeat the step of copying the next byte into the from the source to the destination. So let us have a look at the program. So the program says ORG00H. So the start address of the program is 000H. So default the program counter would be loaded with the value of 000H, but we will cultivate the habit of writing the program in this manner. That means ORG followed by the instructions, and finally we will have the last statement as the end. So the first instruction is move R0, hash 40H. So the source pointer is held in the register R0. The destination pointer or the destination register is held, destination address is held in the register R1. Then R3, hash 10, this is the count because we have to move 10 block of the data from one source to the destination. So what is done is we use an indirect type of register, indirect type of addressing mode. So R0 is pointing to the location 40H. Its contents, right, would be copied into the accumulator, and from the accumulator it would be copied into the destination address, which is pointed by the register R1. The first byte of the data has been copied from the source to the destination. We increment the pointer of the source, that is R0, as well as the destination, that is R1. And DJNZ is the instruction which does two operations. What are they? It decrements the counter. In this case, R3 is used as a counter by a value of 1. So now R3 becomes 9. And it also checks whether its contents are equal to 0. Are they equal to 0? No. So it goes back to copying the next byte of the data. So this whole process will continue till all the 10 blocks or 10 bytes of the data have been copied from the source to the destination with the start address of 40H to the start address of 50H. So let us see the outcome, how it will be. Okay, so this is the complete GUI that you can observe. And most important is when you enter a keel into the debug mode, this is the window that appears. You can see here, this is the register window, which displays all the registers, that is R0, R1, R2, R3 up to R7. It also displays the system registers such as accumulator, B register, stack pointer, program counter, DPTR, and also it has the access to the program status word register. The next most important window that you can observe is the disassemble window. Once we write an assembly program, you save it, you assemble it and compile it and link it. Then how it gets stored into the memory? It would be stored in the form of an operational code or in the machine language. Because we know that every instruction would have an opcode associated with it. So this window gives the information about the disassemble window or the disassemble program. For example, as you can see, the instruction move R3, hash 10, what we have written has been converted into the hex equivalent as 0A. So move R3 will have the opcode as 78 and 0A is the value that we have provided. So similarly, all the instructions whichever we have used in our program would be converted into its opcode equivalent or the machine language equivalent, which is a combination of ones and zeros. Another observation here is, depending upon the number of bytes each of these instruction takes, the program counter would keep on incrementing. Also, the data that would be loaded, that is the program that gets loaded into the code memory, would also depend upon how many bytes each of these instruction takes. And next, this is the simple whatever the program that you have written, it's the edit window. Then next you can see lower here is the memory window. So in the memory window, we have written i:0x40. So whenever we want to look into the code memory, we will write it as c:0x00 or any address where you want to see what is the opcode equivalent of the instructions that you have written. And whenever you want to modify, that means give the input during the runtime or the output, see the output in the memory itself, then it should be written as i:. So in this example, it is at the 40H and 50H. So we just go to the view icon and there you can click on memory. So this window opens up and here I have given as i:0x40 and you can see all the values have been fed over here. So you can simply right click on the memory location and you can modify the values, or you can double click on every location and it will be, and it gives you the provision of modifying it. And you can see that the data after executing would be copied at the location starting from 50H. So this is the code memory. As you can see, I can either write c:00 or it can be 0x00. Both would be acceptable. So same whatever you saw in the disassemble window is observed here in the code memory, which is starting at the location 000H. This is the view of the data memory before the execution. So at the 40th location, we have given 10 bytes of the data, and from 50th onwards, you can see that it will be all 00s. After executing the program, we see the same 10 bytes of the data from the 40 will be copied into the 50H. So 40th will be copied in 50, 41st into 51st, and so on. We can see that byte by byte, the data has been copied from the location starting at 40H to the location, into the destination location starting at 50H. Hope the program is clear to you. So we'll go with the next program. Write an assembly language program, rather 8051 assembly program, to exchange 6 bytes of the data at location 35H and at location 45H. So what this program does, that you have two set of data starting at 35H as well as 45H, and you simply need to exchange, and the size of the exchange is 6 bytes. So the initial process remains the same as we have seen in the previous program. We'll be initializing the counter, we will initialize the source pointer, we will initialize the destination pointer, and then we will exchange the contents of the two memory locations. As I said again, the data transfer between the memory locations cannot happen directly. It has to be done from through the accumulator. So we'll exchange the data from the source into the accumulator and then back to the destination. So if you remember in the C program also, you have been doing such programs exchange where you have used temp as one of the variables. So you'll take from, if the data has to be exchanged between A and B, what we do, the data from A would be transferred into the variable temp. Okay, and then from B it can be transferred into A, and from temp it can be put back into the variable B. So the same method can be used here, or we also have the exchange instruction which does the job of exchanging the data. So we'll use both of them and see how the program has to be written. And then you increment the source pointer as well as the destination pointer. Decrement the count. If it is not equal to 0, then you repeat the above steps. Okay, so this is the program that we have, ORG, which is 00, then R0 pointing to the source or one of the memory location, that is 35H, R1 pointing to 45H. Then R3 is holding the count, which is 06. So the first program that we have written here is not using the exchange instruction. Okay, that is what I said. A data being moved into temp, and then from B you copy into A, and again from temp you copy into B. So here the resistor R4 is used like the temp. So what is done is we copy the data from R0 into accumulator, and from accumulator we save it into the resistor R4, and then from R1 it would be copied into accumulator. So from accumulator you copy into R0. So it means that from the location 45H would be copied into the location 35H. Now R4 contains the value of the 35H, you get it into the accumulator, and through indirect type of addressing mode it can be moved into the resistor, into the memory location 45H pointed by the resistor R1. Increment both the source pointer as well as the destination pointer, and if the the count is equal to 0, you stop, else you repeat. So you can see, to perform the job of exchange, we have almost 3 to 4 additional instructions being used and a temp resistor. So instead, what can be done is we can use the instruction that is exchange, which reduces most of the instructions that we have discussed in the previous logic. So the initializations remain the same. So what we'll do here is we'll get the first byte into accumulator, and we will directly exchange the contents of the accumulator with the destination or the second memory. So whatever was there in the accumulator, which was nothing but the content of the memory location 35H, would be copied right into the memory location 45H, and the content of the 45H would be brought into the accumulator. And next, what we do, we simply use move instruction to copy the data from accumulator into the resistor R0. So we just have these three instructions to be used, which will take care of performing the exchange operation. And then increment the resistor R0, increment the resistor R1, which means you are incrementing the source pointer as well as the destination pointer, and then you decrement the count to see whether it is equal to 0. If it is not equal to 0, then we can directly we need to repeat the above steps so that the next byte can be exchanged. Hope the program is clear and you understand the difference between the two logic or usage of the instructions. So this is how is the output that will be observed on the Keel Microvision. Before execution, we have at 35H, 11, 12, 22, 33, 44, 55 and 66. And at the location 45H, it is 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Any data can be given. And after executing both the programs, either the first program which does not use the exchange instruction, or the program which uses the exchange instruction, does the same job of exchanging both the source as well as the destination. So we observe that whatever are the contents at the location starting from 45H would be moved into the memory location with starting 35H, and the contents starting with 35H would be copied into the location starting at 45H. The next program, write an assembly language program to find the largest element in a given array of 0A bytes at the location 40H. Store the largest number at the location 50H. So we have to find the largest of a number out of 10 bytes. So where are the numbers being stored? They are stored at the location starting at 40H. And finally, the largest number has to be put at the location 50H. So the logic goes like this. We will assume that the first number is the largest number, and then we get the second number. We compare the first number with the second number. If the first number is larger than the second number, then we retain that number itself as the largest. But if we find that the first number is smaller than the second number, then we copy the second number into the first number, because we have assumed that the first number itself is the largest. Okay, so this process will continue for all the 10 bytes of the data. Once all the 10 bytes have been checked, then the location or the first whatever you have assumed would be having the highest number, and that will be copied into the location which is 50H. So we have initialized the counter and the source location. Let the first number be as the largest. So we'll compare the first number with the next. If the second number is greater than the first, exchange, or rather basically copy. Copy the second number into the first number, else you retain the numbers. That means first number itself to be the largest. Increment the source pointer, decrement the count, check whether it is equal to 0. If it is not equal to 0, then you go to the step 2, 3 and 4 and 5 to do the further checking of the numbers for the largest. So let us look into the program. Okay. So we have taken R0 40, R3 we have taken it to be as 9 because we have already will be reading the first number into the accumulator. So the comparison has to be done as 1 less the number of pass. So that's why it's being taken as 9. So the first number is copied into A and it has to be stored into the register R1 temporarily. Because once you perform the subtraction, then the contents of accumulator would change, which means the original value would be lost. So we are loading it into the register R1. Then we increment the register R0, which means that it will point to the next memory location. So we get the next byte or the second byte into accumulator. Clear the carry. Now this content of the second number is again temporarily put into the register R2. Why? Because you need to move across. So we'll subtract the content of A and the contents of the register R1. So on subtracting, if at all there is a carry that is being generated, then we directly, it means that the first number is the largest. So we simply move on to the second comparison or reading the next number. But if not, which what does that mean? If a carry is not being generated, it means that the number which is there in the accumulator, that is the second number, is larger than the first number. So that is what we have done. We have copied that R2, which is second number, into accumulator A, and A into R1, because we have assumed that the register R1 is the one which will hold the largest number. Decrement and repeat this process. So this process will keep on repeating till all the 10 numbers have been checked for. Once it is done, then we will have R0 pointing to 50H, because the final largest number should be loaded into the location 50H. Then whatever is there in the register R1, which is holding the largest number, would be put into the accumulator. And from the accumulator, we are copying it into the memory location pointed by the register R0. So let us see what would be the result. Yes, this is what we have. At 40H, we have the whole of the data, that is 4E, 43, 08, 09, 38 and so on. And finally, at the location which is 50H, we have the largest number. So among all these 10 numbers, we can observe that 4E is the one which has the largest number. And that is what is copied into the location which is 50H. We'll move on to the next program associated with the arithmetic instructions. Write an assembly program to perform the addition of two 16-bit numbers. So normally when it is a 8-bit number, it's a pretty simple program wherein you load the first number into the accumulator. Second number can either be an immediate data or it can be indirectly, or it can be a resistor, or it can be a direct memory. But here we want to perform the addition of two 16-bit numbers, which means that we have to read the first lower byte of the data of number, first number as well as the second number, perform its addition, okay, and store the result. When you are adding the second byte of the number, that means the most significant byte of both the numbers, what we need to consider important here is that the carry has to be considered if it is being generated. Okay, so the first lower byte addition, it would be a simple addition, but for the higher byte addition, it would be considering the carry also. So get the next and perform the addition with the carry and store the result. Okay, so here we have the program. So what we have done in this program is we have assumed that at the location 40H and 41H, we will have the first number, first 16-bit number. And also we have assumed that the lower address will have the lower byte. It's up to you. You can make any assumption. You can say that the higher address will have the lower value and so on. But only care has to be taken in the program to load accordingly. Okay. And then the second 16-bit number is in the location 42 and 43. So if you take this as an example, FF89 plus 24 AAB, the first number. So 89 would be loaded at the location 40H and FF would be loaded at the location 41H. Similarly, for the second number, AB, which is the lower byte, would be loaded into the location 42 and higher byte would be loaded into the location 4324. So when you look at the memory of 8051 in the Kiel Microvision, you would be seeing it in an opposite way. So the first number you would be seeing it as 89FF and second number you would be seeing it as AB24. Okay, so don't be under the wrong concept that it performs the addition as 89FF plus AB24. No. Why? Because in the program that I am explaining, I have assumed that 40th will have the lower byte and 41 will have higher. Similarly, 42 will have the lower and 43 the higher. So we need to get the data of 40th memory location and 42nd memory location. So that's why we have done R0, 40, R1, 42. Get the data into the accumulator. We will clear the carry for a convention way. And then we will add A, at the rate R1. So already A is having the contents of the memory location, that is 40H. And indirectly, we can use this, indirect type of addressing mode along with addition so that it adds the contents of the location, that is 42H. And result is being put onto the 44. So you can use the direct type of addressing mode along with move instruction. So the content of accumulator would be put into the memory location, which is 44. And then increment the resistor R0 as well as the resistor R1. So what happens now? R0 will be pointing to the address 41 and R1 will be pointing to the address, that is 43. And these two locations are holding the higher byte of the 16-bit number. Then pretty simple, again, repeat those steps. You get that number into accumulator, perform the addition. Make an observation here. Here we are not performing a normal addition. We are performing the addition with carry, right? So we say that add C, A, at the rate R1. And the final result would be put into the location, which is 45H. Even after addition, right, of the higher byte, if at all there is a carry that is being generated, then it would be reflected in the program status word register. So let us look at to what would be the result. So here in the execution of the program, I have taken the different inputs. So as per the program, the input, that is the first number, is 40FF and the second number is 60AB. Okay, so after performing the addition of FF with AB, we get the result as AA, and we can see that there is an carry flag as well as the auxiliary carry flag being generated. Right, and on performing the addition of 40 and 60, we should get actually A0, because 4 plus 6 is A and 0 plus 0 is 0. But since the carry is being generated and it has to be considered in the addition of the higher byte, we have used the instruction as add C. That is why we observe that the higher byte, which is the addition of 40 and 60, we are getting it as A1, because there is a carry that is being generated from the lower byte of the addition. That is what we observe in the PSW for the lower byte addition as well as for the higher byte addition. So the higher byte addition, there is no carry, nor there is an auxiliary carry. When the auxiliary carry will be set? The auxiliary carry will be set whenever there is a value 1, okay, from the lower nibble into the higher one, or out of the fourth bit, if there is a carry generated, then the auxiliary carry will be set equal to 1. We move on to the next program. Write an assembly language program to perform the addition of 10 8-bit numbers. So this is basically a series addition. Fine. So again, the logic is same as we have done with the addition. Only here we have to add 10 bytes, or rather 10 numbers, which wherein each of them are 8-bit each. So we have assumed again the RAM location to be as 40H, which is being initialized as the source as well as the counter. So we'll get the first number and also get the next byte or the next number and perform the addition. You check if the carry is set. Now, why are we considering the carry here? Assume that you have the numbers all to be FFF. Right, so you have got 10 numbers wherein all of them, worst of the worst condition, they all are FFF. So obviously, when you add 10 F's together, the result will be greater than 8-bit. Fine. So to incorporate that higher byte, what we are doing here is we are checking whether a carry is being generated. If a carry is being generated, then temporarily we'll increment one of the resistor. So that resistor which is being incremented will hold the higher byte of the result, because the addition of 10 8-bit numbers necessarily not be a 8-bit number. It can be a 16-bit number. So in the program, we have to make a provision, okay, for taking care of the result to be as a 16-bit. Then decrement the count, check if the count is 0. If so, you simply end, else you go to step 3 and repeat the process. Finally, you store the result. So let us look at the program. That is program 5. Yeah. So again, we use the resistor R3. You can use any other resistor. Conventionally, I have used it as R3. You can use R4, R5, R6 and R7, any one of them. Try not to use R1 and R0, because any moment of time you may require those resistors to hold the address of the RAM location. Okay, so the 10 bytes of the data are held at 40H and it's being pointed by the resistor R0. We'll clear the carry. Then we get the first byte of the data into the accumulator, and we are decrementing R3 by 1, because the next process, since already you have got the first byte, next would be second, third, fourth. There will be only 9 numbers which have to be got into and perform the addition. So you perform the addition A, at the rate R0. If there is no carry that is being generated, then simply you come to this label down, decrement R3, and again go up to get the second byte and third byte and perform the addition. But by chance, as I said, the first two numbers are themselves to be as FF. So the addition of FF with another FF will be a 16-bit data. So it will be 1FE. So now that 1 which is there will be stored as a carry. So we will check if at all there is a carry that is being generated, it comes to this instruction. Okay, so the register R4 is incremented by a value of 1. So this will hold the higher byte or the out of the 16 bit of the result, the higher 8 bit of the result would be held in the register R4. Then again decrement the count and you repeat. So let us see. Okay, so that is how it goes with. You can execute and also you can check for the result. Any 10 numbers can be taken and it can be verified. The next one is write an assembly program to perform the addition of 10 8-bit BCD numbers. So the fifth program that we have discussed is for a normal number. That means it's a basically an hexadecimal addition over there. But here it is the BCD. That means the input is BCD and result also is expected to be a BCD, valid BCD result. So we have already studied the instruction which converts the non-BCD number into BCD. That is, we'll be using the instruction as DA. So we have the RAM location pointed to, pointed by the register R0, which is 40H. Then initialize the source and the counter, get the first number and get the next byte and perform the addition. Once we perform the addition, there is every possibility that the result is a hexadecimal, but what we want is a BCD number. Hence we use the instruction which is decimal adjust after addition to the number, then decrement the count, check if it is zero. If so, you end, else you go to step 3 and repeat. Okay, so this is the same program here. So after add, what we will do is we will use the instruction as DA. Okay, so how this program basically works is, let me take an example. So when you perform the addition, say I have the first number to be as 99, the numbers that we have, I'll say it as H, then comma 10H, right, comma then 34H and so on. So internally what happens when you perform the addition of 99 plus 10. So what we expect the result, if it is a BCD, I should be getting it as 109. But we will not get this as a result, because on addition, what do we get? Instead, when we add 99 and 10, I'll be getting the result as A9, because 9 plus 0 is 9 and 9 plus 1 is 10, which is A. Okay, so is it a valid BCD? No, it's not a valid BCD. So it comes to this instruction DA. Now what this instruction does is, it checks for the number. It checks for the lower nibble as well as the higher nibble. Now when it checks for the lower nibble, it checks for two conditions. What are those conditions? Whether the number is less than 9, right? Or whether the auxiliary carry flag is generated or not. So if the first condition is true, the number is less than 9, as it is in our case also. Now is the auxiliary carry flag being generated? No. So both the conditions fail. That means neither the lower nibble is greater than 9 nor the auxiliary flag is being generated. So it does not add 06. That means the lower nibble is a valid BCD. Now come to the higher nibble in the example. What is a higher nibble? The same conditions are being checked. Only instead of auxiliary carry, it checks for the carry flag. So again it checks, is the number greater than 9? Yes, perfect. The number is greater than 9 because A is greater than 9. So what it does is, to this value of A9, it will add the number that is 60. Right? So when you add A9 with 60, what is A? Is a 10. 10 plus 6 is 16. Okay, I'm doing a decimal addition. So 16, its hex equivalent will be what? 10. So finally, what we get the result to be as 109. Because the addition of 9 plus 0 will be 9 and A plus 6 would be equal to 10. And hence we can observe that we get the number in the form of BCD itself. Okay, so that's the advantage of using the die instruction. Again here, if at all the carry is being generated, then you increment R4 because I need to incorporate the second byte. Like for example, if 99 plus 99, what is the answer? The answer is 198, right? So the answer would be what? The addition of these two would be 198, but only 98 will be held in the accumulator after addition and da. So that one what is there as a part of the result would be held into the resistor R4. So we have to make a provision of holding the higher byte in the program. Hope the program is clear to you.